try to do in the department is to provide opportunities for students to experience cultures that are different from what they are used to. And the CAP Asia program is one such program. It takes students to Asia to work with faculty and students in these countries. Almost all of them come back transformed. Transformed in their view of the world, transformed in the way they approach planning in the US, even when they stay here to practice planning. The CAP Asia program has also won several awards, the Fulbright Award. Won the Fulbright Award 3 consecutive times. And this speaks to the quality of the program. I am very eager to see what it is that our students have experienced in the CAP Asia program in the last trip, that is last year. So please join me in welcoming them back officially. And we are eager to see your presentation. Okay?
Welcome everyone. My name is Nirmani, and I have my CAP Asia team here. We went to Malaysia, China, Thailand, and Singapore this time. So I'm trying to begin the presentation by giving you like a very brief overview of what CAP Asia is. And thanks, Professor Burayidi, for the introduction. And so CAP Asia, it has been happening since 1999, so it's like 16 years old now as a program. And the best word for me to put this is as an immersive semester. I know the immersive is a word that's overloaded, but that's overused maybe in different ways. But CAP Asia, you will see how it immerses. And then, so it's an immersive semester in Asia, and then it has been to these countries in all these years. And so this time, as I said, it's the larger portion of the program was in Malaysia, and then we were in Changsha, China, and we also touched Thailand and Singapore briefly. And so this is actually a journey where we explore ourselves, like putting ourselves in different contexts and try to understand or try to look at ourselves, how we behave and what we are actually. And that's the more spiritual side of it. And then we try to observe and we try to explore communities and then how they use space and then how they empower themselves through that use. And then we basically do two collaborative projects. When I say collaborative, it's we connect with the communities and also local faculty, local students. So we do two collaborative projects in two main locations, and we also go to other locations in between. So the first, the biggest project is 7 weeks long, and the second one is 3 weeks. And participants, we get participants from different locations and different backgrounds. Like this time, we have Rebecca from English department, and then we have Nelly from landscape, and we also had we have Christine, she's not here today, from architecture department, and we had Emily, she's from a different university. And so when we, I will try to focus a little bit to the CAP Asia this time, and especially the Malaysia component. And so if I put it in a, it's really hard to put it in a linear process. It's like, it's a process that like these steps, they happen as we, it happened all the time. It's not like, okay, we settled in and it's over. We went to the place and we learn everything, like something new every day. So we keep adapting ourselves. So if I try to simplify it into a linear process, then we first try to like, so the 7 weeks, like this is the beginning of the project, and then we go to this place, and this was Penang this time, Penang, Malaysia, and specifically Georgetown area where we lived. So we try to settle in the city, we try to figure out where we stay, where do we eat, and all those stuff. And then we bond with local students and local faculty who will be helping us throughout the project. And then we find sites. We actually went to different sites and we finalized we'll take these three sites. And then when we see the site, we immediately don't decide what the project is. So we try to understand the site and then see the site, observe it to see what it is. And then eventually we find our projects and themes where we can work on. And then the one large principle is we go to site every day for these 7 weeks. We try to go every day. And so we keep observing. It's observant participatory observation. And so when we participate for a few weeks, then we see windows through which we can intervene. And at the end, we share the experience and we try to intervene little strategically without harming the process. One big thing that I want to highlight here is this cycle that happened pretty much every day while we are on CAP Asia and still it's still happening after coming back. So what we do is we meet in the morning. This is like a normal day. I'm just trying to summarize a normal day. So in the morning, we get up and we have readings that we did from the last day. And then so we go to take breakfast, and then we discuss this. We have a class that's during breakfast. So we try to discuss these readings and relate them to the experience, the experience on the field that we had the day before. And then we go to the field, and when we come back, we use those frames, or we use that that reading and discussions we had in the class to understand what we observed, what we experienced. So this cycle is taking place every day. It's, if I put it in a simple word, it's reflective learning. It's a process of reflective learning. And so this time, this is the main place that we stayed while we were in Malaysia. And this is Hang Cho Hotel. This is located in a World Heritage City, which is Georgetown, Penang. And so we had very odd classes, meetings. If you can see, this is a hallway. And so these are the very charming kind of, all these things are if you see the chair that she's showing, it's made in Finland in 1959. So she's sharing that experience. She's, okay, do you want to know about this chair? And it's even living in that place, it's an experience, and it's part of this learning. So you see some moments from the place. And this is the next thing is to familiarize ourselves to the place and understand the place, and then try to figure out, okay, how are we going to go to the site every day? So we have to figure out bus routes. We have to figure out where we meet. So this is kind of a negotiation. We meet at the breakfast place downstairs, and then they don't ask us to go out, because it's like advertisement for the hotel. They meet every day, and we also have breakfast while we discuss our readings. So it was a very, very nice experience. And then this is these are the students who helped us when we were in Malaysia, and that's Professor Lilik Meng, who was the local faculty who guided us. So these guys, they not only bridge the gap of language, it's they bridge the gap of culture. It's they pretty much tell us do's and don'ts. And so it's a guided immersion. We immerse ourselves, but it's always guided by local people. We don't just assume that we know, and we don't just go do things the way we do here or anywhere else. So when we go through the process, we don't even see these opportunities at the beginning, but eventually there are opportunities that we can immerse more, invitations for lunches, and then some religious events, religious places that we pass. And then we also have some little middle-class moments in Nihal's woods. This is little bit of touristy stuff that we do in between to relax ourselves and also to experience the place. So I will also get into the first project. We actually did three projects when we were in Malaysia, and this is the first project. This project was focused on the Tanjung Tokong Malay community and their traditional, it's a traditional village that is being forced into a process of transformation towards more urban culture. So they are forced to live in high rise, and then right now this community is in the transition program, transition process, where they are removed from, so this is the location, and they've been removed from this Kampung Belachan, like little above that, not to that, from that area, and they've been taken to these transit houses where they are settled for 8-9 years now. So the planners take, like, the program is to remove these people from the original site, put them in transit houses, and they build high rises at the same location. So if you can understand the land values and then and stuff, like, so they take little bit of space and build high rise, and there's a lot more space gained by the developer for other purposes. So what happened is these transit homes, they were settling from 2006, and the final family, the last family moved in 2012, and they are still there. So for 8-9 years, these people have been here. So the planning process goes on, they build houses and everything, it's going on. But at the same time, life is happening. Like, when they are in the transit houses, the new babies are born, the adults are dead, and then there are weddings, and life takes place in this transition process. So we try to observe how, in which form the life takes place in this place, and how do people transform these transit homes in this temporary setting, how do they transform that space to support the way they want to live in that place. So what you see there is the transit houses. They are built in like rows, like this. And what you see behind in this picture below is the actual kind of development that takes place in that surrounding area. So I will just try to brief three areas in this project, that we three things that we saw. First thing is how they familiarize themselves and how they adapted these transit houses to suit their life. So first things, the small things are like these adding some plants, and then adding lines, like creating spaces to dry clothes, and then adding the family gathering spaces. And then in this one, what you see is, like, it's an extended family who got like two units, and they built the wall in between. Now they have a bigger living room. So this is like little transformations, little adaptations they make to make their life easy in that place. And this, you can see the sense of belonging. He's cleaning all these areas around his house. And then these are like very nice things that people, especially women, began in this place to create a life, create opportunities for themselves. If you see, this community actually blew off our understanding of a Muslim community. And this is, it's a community led by women, actually. And if you see in that picture and in this one, this is women who try to create little kiosks where they cook. And if you, in that picture, what you see is a woman taking whatever she cooked at home to these little kiosks where they can sell them and earn some money while having a social life there. And then this is a little banana garden that's created behind the transit houses on a land that's owned by the government, but not necessarily used for anything. So they don't want these banana gardens to go be there forever, but they are making use while the space is available. And this is a school transport service that's run by a woman. We call her Machi Rosna. She's a woman, and she figures out, like, being a woman is a very good opportunity to become a safe school transport service provider for little girls and boys. So she's more trusted than the male drivers. So she creates that opportunity, and she makes use of, like, their houses are removed, like, from one place, and they are now somewhere else. Now that has created distance from the original schools these babies were going to, and these kids were going to, and then now she is making use of that distance. It's an opportunity for her. So they are very, very creative. And at the same time, so they are in the transit homes, they are creating a life there, but at the same time, they make sure the struggle to get better housing for long term is going on. But who you see there is Musanif, he's the community leader, and then these are some publications they had in media about their struggle. Like, they are trying, first they had to go through a huge struggle to get deeds for houses that they will be getting, and then to come into terms with the contractors and so on. And then now they are in a process to make changes to the layout of houses. So this is like they know what they want, and this is a journey that they are taking to make sure they get what they want. And we also tried to we met actually with the planner to give our understanding, our idea of to contribute to these designs and so on. And we believe that was successful. And I would like to pass to the next group, which is Rifle Range. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. How's everyone doing? Awesome. So this is Rifle Range, and I feel like Rifle Range tells the story of how people's agencies will change their space. So a little background history. Rifle Range is the first high-rise built in Penang. It was made through like German engineers who won a competition, and then them alongside Malaysian laborers built this. And while we were doing our research, we noticed, well, actually, we tried to find the original plan to make comparisons to, you know, what has changed over the years. Turns out there wasn't one. The engineers just simply decided to kind of like plop these buildings everywhere on the site, and then just leaving people to deal with whatever wasn't planned for. So people have changed the way they deal with the interior space as well as the exterior space. And this is just kind of like a brief looking into like how the apartments are set up. So everybody does have one bedroom, one bath, one small living room and kitchen, and a very small balcony. And we managed to get the identity of this community through the people's story. So we did have a lot of discussions, and we did get along with a lot of the local people. So we noticed that people started making these spaces their own, one of those being the leftover spaces. They repurposed these for recreational purposes. You can see people doing, they're called town square dances. People get together and they organize different like wellness groups, and they'll meet throughout the day. People also put together social spaces. And this is something that kind of just developed. Like I said, the original plan didn't put these in, or it didn't design for social spaces, so people just decided, hey, I'm going to put a chair here, and then eventually the chair became a bench. And eventually that bench, you know, had a roof over it, and then people will decorate these. And a lot of people take pride in these. There's actually a set schedule for the group of men that we did become familiar with. They'd have a space in the morning, and then when it gets too hot, they'll move under a tree. And then if it gets too cold, they'll move back out. And so these people like will cycle through the entire site eventually by the end of the day. Another form of agency and emergence that we did see was markets. These markets each meet at a different time and a different day, and they each meet different needs. So a lot of these will complement each other instead of like compete. So you'll have like a fruit market and a vegetable market, and they'll each be in different sides. You'll have food, like food stalls and kiosk that kind of go out throughout the day, so people don't necessarily, you know, oh, she sells rice, so I'm not going to sell rice. It's just like, oh, she sells rice in the morning, I'm going to sell rice in the evening kind of thing. And then another thing, which I feel like, especially in landscape architecture, that we talk a lot is about parking and parking design. Like I mentioned again before, the original design did not include parking, and so people have gone out and they like design their own like parking system where they won't put the safety brake on. They'll just they'll leave it off, and then they have this system of like pushing and pulling the cars. And everybody has more than one vehicle, and everybody has more than one motorcycle, which I think is very interesting. So overall, I feel like Rifle Range, it kind of like, it told me the story of how like we forget that, you know, people are designers too, and people are able to manage their space, and if given the freedom, people will, you know, find and fill their needs. Now I'd like to pass it on to the group, or the Clan Jetty group.
Hello everyone, my name is Jahubai. Welcome to Clan Jetties. Clan jetties, there are 6 jetties in that area. And 100 years ago, the Chinese people come to this area, settled along the jetties, work as laborers. They ship the cargoes from the ship to the land. And now it's changed to the lively neighborhood in this area.
So we were a group that never could be apart, so we are going to present together. So now this Klanjeti site is a World Heritage Site. So they built this place and they transformed this place naturally, but now it's a World Heritage Site. Now it doesn't belong to the people who live there, but it belongs to the world. So now they have guidelines and they have different regulations, so people cannot change their houses, they cannot change their neighborhood the way they want. So when we talk to people, we realize that they have really nice stories. They have a different meaning. They have different meanings for the place that they live. For any place, for 1,000 different people, there will be 1,000 different meanings. So when we were there, we didn't want to create our own meaning to the place. We didn't want to create our own story to the place. And we just wanted to know what the place means to people who live in that place. So we met some interesting people as pop-up tribe, as they called in Jetis to our group. We had this interesting time. We had this exciting time in Clan Jetis. And we met these nice different people. And we learned different things from those people. So do you want to talk about Amila?
OK, Amila is the only one is non-resident, non-Malaysian, non-Chinese and run business in the Klan Jetis. He married to a Klan Jeti woman. So he used to have a fruit shop here, and then he used his talent with drawing to change that to an art gallery. Here is a build master. He learned how to fix jetties when he was young. He learned from the old people. They teach him how to fix the jetties. And now his son, you can see that's her, that's his son, also learned the same skill from him. He also cooked very delicious food for us. This is a hot pot. He makes jetty like a second home for us. Here is An. He liked to work with tourists and guide us to the interesting things in Penang. He also liked to share his own experience. Now let's talk about the special area plan. Government has a special area plan for the jetties, but jetty people, they don't know what will happen in here. They don't even know this plan will happen in this place. So what do we do next?
So now these people have interesting stories, and they have a place that they cannot change, and they have to live according to the way the world wants to keep it, that place. And government is going to propose something for this place, and people don't know anything about this plan. And government thinks they know. So we heard about this because we were accessible for this information. And we went to those touristy places also. So we heard about this plan, and then we talked to these people about this proposal. And then they didn't know anything. So this is Chu Hokiam, if you wonder. He was in our caricatures also, our posters also. So He was really interested in knowing about this process, and he wanted to talk to other people about the government's plan. So he helped us to arrange a committee meeting. He asked representatives from different jetties to come, and we talked to them about a special area plan. And After our presentation, after we talked to them about what's going on in the government and what are they going to do to their place within next 5 years, they were really interested to talk to these people. They didn't know that they can go to government agencies and they can talk. They didn't know that. But after we talked to them and after we explained them about the procedures in the government, then they really wanted to go and talk to these people. And then they decided, okay, when we are in different clans, when we are in different groups, we are not that powerful to go and talk to these agencies, government agencies, and so on. So we are going to form an interjati committee, and we will go and talk to these government agencies about their proposal and what we want to get done in our place. So our next step was we went to the government agencies, and we talked. This picture shows the meeting that we had in the World Heritage Site in Penang. So we talked to them about this informational gap. We told that you are doing the maximum that you want to do and you can do, and you are doing everything to publish about this proposal and everything, but people who live on jetties, they don't know about this proposal. So we, as well as we invited the leader of the interjetty committee, Mr. Chu Hokiam, to this meeting, and we introduced Chu Hokiam to this place, and then he knew what is this place about and how he can talk to these people. So this was our last step. So after we brought those two parties together, then they had a public hearing. Actually, this Penang World Heritage Office, they had two public hearings, and first public hearing, nobody in Jetis, they knew about this public hearing. So nobody didn't go to this place, and nobody didn't give their proposals, and they didn't know about this proposal. But the last public hearing, which was actually held in the in our last day in Penang, I was not there, but they were there in the meeting. So these people, they talked to government about this proposal, and they gave their feedback, and they talked about what they really want to get done in their place. So they really participated very well in this process. So finally, what we could do is we brought those two parties together, and now they can talk to each other, and they can negotiate about what they want to get done in their own community. So our final step was to watch the success that we created. So we helped to create. So this was what we got in Malaysia, and then you will take us to China.
Hello everyone, this is Yui. And I feel so honored to have this group in my hometown Changsha for 3 weeks this spring. And they also brought me a lot of surprises. So first I will just briefly introduce the background of the community. I just came home somehow just write this as my thesis because it's fantastic community. And it is a Danwei, we call it Danwei community, which is like a work unit community. It belongs to a factory, like an old switch factory with a state-owned enterprise. And an old like planned economy period in China, like when you have the state-owned enterprise, they have freedom basically to acquire land. So basically the government assign you a land and you can build whatever on it. So they copied the kind of a model from Souvenir called Small and Complete. So at that time they have the factory, and their community is next to the factory, and they build their kindergartens, they build like community center, they have public canteens, because at that time it's all group living. Resources are assigned, not like individualized. So they don't have the kitchen in the room, they all go to the public canteen, and then they experience a transformation. So everybody knows like everything is commodified, and then they gradually go to the market economy. And for most of these kind of communities in China, they're torn down, especially in the small towns in Changsha and everywhere, because they cannot, I don't know, it's changed too fast around. They're like, they don't have like enough fire protection, maybe like their road condition is not good, with all of these reasons. But for this community, it survived, which gave me a huge surprise, because the factory leader decided to gradually change the land with like privatize the land. So gradually, he sells some land of the factory in other places and then build new modern houses inside the community. So in this community, you can see the houses and different time period. So I'm so glad to have them here because also it's like coming like after Malaysia, all of us kind of gain ability to observe. Actually, it seems like very easy. We just observe things, but usually people don't have this ability. See, if you go to a community, you will see, okay, there is no sidewalks, okay, and there is not enough parking. Like, all of our world is constructed in your mind. We just lost ability to respect a new things, which the things we don't know. And if you go there with no framed ideas, you will see a different community. According to my interview to the head of planning department in Changsha, she said the only way they cannot do anything for this community because they are poorer ones. Like, so we don't have enough fundings, so now we will deal with those ones and this one will come after that. So for this community, basically it is abandoned, but also it is the reason why it is survived. So, and you can see how these people, they're so quickly cooperate with the local students, so we cooperate with the local university. It's my old university in China. It's called Central South University of Forestry and Technology. And they went to the market, and they went to karaoke in the people's house. They saw, like, they participated in the card playing. They were dancing with the community members. And this is maybe a little bit similar with our, like, picture in Malaysia. Like, we gather someplace. This is a KFC, actually. It's pretty modernized. So we were there, and I still remember in this time we were reading like Science of Modeling Through, right? Yeah, okay, so we were learning the methodology from all these classes with Nihao, and he'll just go away and let us just be free in the community. So everybody chose a perspective they're interested in, and they just dig into that. And those are so fascinated. So I will briefly talk about them, and some of them will like talk in detail later. So first is Kaushala. She went with like filling the gap. She was looking for, because there's an old market which is came from, like, because the life changed, it's individualized. The public canteen are canceled, so gradually people need to buy food. They need to support their everyday life. So gradually there is a market just coming there, but it's very informal. So, and the developer finally used 10 years to try to deal with the government, deal with the community, deal with the factory, with the planning department, with everything. He wants to do a formal market. So now they're in the competition, but after they left, actually the formal market was shutting down because the formal one just failed. They just don't know how to run that here. So Kaushala, she found a very interesting like tea making place in the new market, which actually the people in the new market, they're not having a good business, but they also are enjoying their life there. They create a tea place, they can gather together and talk every day when there is no customers. And Rebecca find like she just so obsessed in this mahjong like houses. We said maybe it's like half of her Chinese gene just worked. So like she just cannot live without mahjong anymore. So she observed from the mahjong house. Mahjong house is a very socialized places in China. Almost everyone knows how to play mahjong, and every middle to old age people will go to different kind of mahjong houses, and it's full of, like, you can call it like a social drama place. And this is like Christine's group. She didn't come here because she is in somewhere in Europe, I don't know. And she did a fantastic job to looking at the in-between spaces. So we like see like the abstract space and lived space. So people transform the spaces according to the different needs. So like if we look at the left upper side of it, it's like a medicine uncle. He is just trying, he just, you know, now we learn from Western, so we put grassland every place. But no, we don't maintain it, so it just destroys it later. So what he is doing, like, it's a grassland here. People cannot step on it, and it's dying, and nobody cares about it. So what he is doing, he is going to just plant some medicine there. So he planted a lot of medicine plants. It's very well, it's very good looking, and also all the people in this community basically sometimes go to him to find these herbs for free. So he's loving to do that. And a lot of people, because they are the factory workers, now they're pretty aged, so they're like old. So this is basically their life. And like the chicken grandma, and like the grandma just see, okay, there's a dead place in front of me again, I will just run some chickens on it. I can use the chicken poops to do some other stuff. So see, like the sidewalks, people use to do like chicken, their community park, they build like flowers and medicines. Like gradually the people in upper floors, they just envy these people in the first floor because they can suddenly have some more space. So they then sue them in the community, but you know, it's a factory thing. They negotiated, but you know, they will still work together. So, and then some of them did the observation of a pavilion. It's they see the transformative space, so people like play cards on it. They also pick their vegetables. And for some people, they said, I spend like 5 to 6 hours a day in this place. Like all the, my awake, like the time I'm not asleep, I'm here. So they are here, and Simran is going with the like disability, and she is always fascinated with that. And after she just danced in the community, she just suddenly found this person, and she was so surprised about like how this person actually lived pretty well here. Yes, they are struggling. They are struggle. It's not like everything is satisfied. But when a person came here, like designer, we had a Sri Lankan designer who was there. After he hear about disability, he will say, okay, you don't have that, you know, floor is not designed for disability and all of this kind of stuff. But when you actually go to see his story, what he needs actually is like some housework. His mom is not all available for his housework. And he just, and factory, because it's a very small community and the factory kind of managed to get it. Simran will talk about it later. And the last thing is Nelly's about things on walls, which is so surprised to me because she came and asked, oh, those things on the walls, you guys probably will see them in the exhibition. Like, and everybody was wondering what that is, but actually it is very, if you ask me, I don't even know. It's like so common. I don't know how to make an example of that. It's like you pass it every day, like from my childhood to here, but we just never think it's important. But when they went there, they find a hidden social network like on these walls. So later I will pass it to them to talk a little bit about that. So first is Rebecca about her mahjong place.
Okay, here we go. Okay, so I'm in the English department, and I'm a creative writing student, so I did a little bit of, you know, a little bit of creative writing. So this is sort of what I wrote about this mahjong place, which if you don't know how mahjong works, it's using these tiles, they're kind of like cards, but they're like heavier and they like clack and it's cool. But you use them and it's kind of like you're playing almost like a poker sort of game. And that's really what the environment of the mahjong houses is supposed to be, is like more like, is it's kind of like the back room playing cards and poker, sort of like underground, but not really kind of area, and people gamble while they're playing and things like that. So this is a little bit about that place. His yellowed nails tap tiles, the pad of his middle finger curls smooth, brush across the bottom and flip, flick into the center pile, easy familiarity, easy weight, even edges, braille-esque feel for lettering, tap, 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 click, bump, click, thump, that, clack, thump, draw. The shop owner hands out loyalty cards, meals and tea, slicked comb over black and gray hair, thin, shuts down at 6 to cook dinner, everyone home. We walked in at 12 when the metal door came up to find him pulling on boots and a grin. Lunch means stools outside, means neighbors and noodles, laugh-lined futures. The woman with unforgiving eyes smokes, laughs with food in her mouth and seems a sailor, fills spaces, carries herself like hardwood furniture, a stone house. These tiles clack mahjong beats, smack, slip, slide on green velvet tabletops, break, deck, slap, clack, smoke in the air, in their lungs, in my face, seeds in teeth, shells on floor, crooked teeth, clack, kaleidoscope, smiles, and I'm learning to listen with fingers. So that's the artsy version. That's like the artsy version of what I did. And then this is the planning version of what I did. So sort of what I ended up like finding from spending a lot of time in this place and like learning how to play mahjong and finding out from all of these people who are so amazing at playing that they can like turn the tile and they've got like a little bit of an indent on the tile and they can feel the bottom and know which tile it is, which is crazy to me. But they're so familiar with the game that they can do that. And so I spent a lot of time with these people who like I can't talk to because they speak Mandarin and I don't speak Mandarin. And I had my partner there, but it's really difficult to translate when you're playing against her, you know, and she's trying to win and you're trying to win. So I had, there were, what would happen would be I would be sitting there and I would be trying to play, and there would be someone standing behind me who just couldn't bear to watch me do something so stupid as what I was going to do. So he would take and he would like flick the right tile in for me, and he would like discard it, and I would just be like, why did you do that, and have to figure it out. And so a lot of the learning that I did about strategy and understanding how to play was very observational based. And so this is sort of like the cycle of what I went through. So what would happen would be each individual person that would be like standing behind me about to flick the tile in would have a strategy in their mind. And then they would do something and I would make an observation about what they did. And based on that observation, I would make an assumption or a guess about why they did that. And then from that, I would come up with my own strategy. The problem arose when I made the wrong assumption about why someone did something, and then my strategy would be completely awful because I didn't know why, and so I was using the wrong reasoning in order to plan my next moves. And this really, after I realized and I thought about it, I realized that this was really basically what we were doing the entire semester. We were observing people, observing what they were doing without necessarily knowing why they were doing it. And then we would make assumptions or guesses about why they were doing what they were doing. And then we would come up with the final reason or the final assumption about what people were doing and why they were doing it. And the thing is, in order to come up with the complete understanding of what people are doing and why they're doing it based on like observing what they're doing, you need to communicate with them. And you need to be able to ask questions and you need to interact with them, because it was so hard to understand why people were flicking my tiles into the middle of the table and why people were telling, like, were indicating, use this piece, don't use this piece. Because you can come up with a conclusion, but you can't come up with a conclusion based on single observations. It takes so much longer if you can't talk to someone. And so, I don't know, I realized that that's just what CAP Asia was really about, was understanding how to use observation to learn and then how to bridge that gap by talking to people and by communicating and asking questions. So yeah, it was fun. It was a very exciting time learning how to play mahjong. If you want to learn, I can teach you. I probably remember it still. So come see me afterwards. And now I'm going to turn it over to Simran, who's yeah.
Hello everyone. I will be talking about coexistence. I mean, disability is definitely part of my research, but the first thought that came when I actually began to understand what it is about, it was coexistence. Before introducing to my project, I would like to first play this little video. What did you feel? I will tell you about what is it exactly about. But before introducing to this man, I will tell you a little story about it. I didn't encounter him on the first day when I visited the site. I encountered this family on my third day of the visit. What I saw is, I saw some women who were actually picking up some clothes from the garbage bins, and that actually fascinated me. And then I went to those women and I asked, what are you doing? And then they told me that these are the used clothes that people, you know, just dump in into the dustbins, and then they, you know, choose out the best one that they can wear. And if they are left, people will use it either to sell to some other people who would love to buy it for like cheap price, or maybe for some other purpose. And this is the location where his house was. And when I talked to the lady, then I realized that she is having a son who is 53 years old, and she is taking care of that person. And this person, his name is John Lee, and he has already been, you know, developed all these disabilities, the cognitive, hearing and speech. He cannot see, he cannot, move perfectly. Like, he has paralytic strokes, like, thrice, and those were, like, consecutive. And the moment he got his first stroke, he was out of the factory. I mean, the factory was like, now you are a liability, so we cannot take care of you anymore. So he was, he started living with his family. The family, they both, both the parents, father, most of the time he's not around him, but he has like a perfect schedule of taking care of him. And the mother, they both are like 72 years old, and they both have only one thing to do in their daily routine, and that's taking care of their son. how they are taking care and how these things are happening, it's very complicated to understand. Now, why I was interested in this particular family and why coexistence came into my mind. Because most of the time when I used to tell about disability, the first thing that always, you know, my professors taught me was like designing the best environment for them, like accessible environment. But in that video, if you would have noticed, there was not that perfect accessible environment. But he managed to do it. He was actually practicing these steps every day, and it actually takes him like 1 hour to do his routine. But what was he doing? After taking his meal, he has to walk. Because if he will not walk, he will not be able to move in his entire life then. So he has to walk. But all of the time, his mother cannot come and, you know, just help him for those things. So this is how he has, you know, continued to do these things. And he is not doing all these things by himself. The society is also helping. How? I mean, now that's another question. The passage that you saw, they will never block that passage. And when I asked, did the parents told them to do so? And they were like, no. It was, we just felt that, you know, he needs this space to maneuver, to get to the street and do whatever he wants to do. They don't even park vehicles on the street. And if they do, it's not on the side where he lives. The government has provided them, you know, houses that are actually, like the son is living on the ground floor and the mother, the parents are living on the first floor. And it's not a policy. It's not at all any liability to do. It was just based on understanding. That was something, you know, that actually amazed me. And not just that, people, if you see these pictures, you will see that there are like different locations, but they all are around his house. All of them, whenever, I mean, Chinese people have this habit of playing cards and, you know, just have some idle thing to do whenever they are idle, or maybe, I don't know, they just find out time to do so. They are always around that house. And whenever he comes out, at least there is some person who knows that he is out. And if anything ever happens, they are there to actually acknowledge that thing, and they will let the parents know. And why I'm saying that, I've been there for like 2.5 weeks. So, and I have been, you know, going there for like every day. So on the basis of that thing, I mean, that observation, I'm telling this. It's not just I'm making up things. They all pay, and I will just go back to the first slide just to show you. If you see the first slide on the left, all the things that are placed there, they are not just placed for fun. He actually uses all these objects to maneuver. The chair, he uses that as a stick sometimes, just to hold it. I have some more couple of videos, but I cannot show all of them here. So it's like a complete technique that he is using to complete his walk in his day. Then, of course, the government part I've already told you. But then the NGOs. Okay, we all know that NGO works for charity and, you know, they provide financial help and they provide financial guidance in some ways. But have you ever heard of any NGO whom you can just call upon and just tell them that we need help for a household course? Have you ever heard? Because I didn't hear any of it before this. The NGO that the government has provided them, the mother can actually call them at any time of the day and they will come and help her in the daily course. And she said, we are financially weak, but it's not the main thing that we need. Because we are aging, we need the people to actually help us in the daily course, so that because nobody is there to help her, so when they come and help them with the daily course, like it's like smaller, it can be small as, you know, just putting one thing from other and just, you know, placing any of the object from ground floor to the first floor or anything like that. So they will just come and help them. It's like any time of the day. And while just, you know, doing all these research, I felt that among us, who is not disabled? I mean, in some sense, we all are. Disability is not just about that you can see. There are many invisible disabilities. Some are defined as blindness, hearing impairment, but there are many other disabilities that are developed over a period of time. And disability is not about just providing the accessible environment. It's about the freedom. If we can go anywhere without thinking of anything, like most of things, and you know, we can access to life opportunities, so what about the disabled? These were the major things that I've learned, but there was something that actually struck me, and that was that disability is more excruciating when it's intellectual and not physical. And there were like these were the some of the questions that what is the difference between understanding and knowledge about disability or the disadvantaged groups that we study, or maybe anything, because there is a difference between understanding something and knowing something. And this is something that we require whenever we plan or, you know, study any topic. That's it. Thank you.
Alright, the small project that I did is called Things on Walls, and it's literally observations of the things that are on walls. So I spent most of my day just like staring at walls, trying to figure out what was going on. This is the first time I've ever been in China, and so I was like amazed by Chinese characters, their use of colors, and like the different forms of advertisement that they have. So here are some more pictures of what that looks like. Notice how the numbers are especially interesting, I think. So one of the first things that I looked at was like formal versus informal forms of advertisement. So kind of like what differentiates between the two. And so I've noticed that people would use like printed things, and they'd use like glue and stick it to the wall, whereas other people would take markers or spray paint and just do it directly on the wall. And I kind of noticed the difference between what they were advertising between the two. Those who were asking or like had formal advertisements were more legitimate businesses, things like moving companies, people asking for like nurses, people asking for childcare. People who wrote things on the walls with markers were pretty much soliciting, I guess, illegal services. And so I asked, I kind of like walked around and I asked people, like, how do you feel about this? Like, I understand that advertisements add kind of like a different layer, a different dimension to space in terms of like what is on the wall. And so I asked, like, how do you feel about this? Like, how do you feel about all these different colors, but also how do you feel about that number that, you know, you can get an illegal certificate or you can get another illegal service done. Like, how does that make you feel? Kind of like, how does that deal with your community? Do you think it properly identifies your community? Things like, what would you change? How would you change it? And so these are a few of the responses that they gave me. Most of them, it was like a negative response. They thought that it made their community look ugly. They thought that it made their community look dishonest because they felt that, you know, I mean, this is one of the few communities where we saw the numbers. And so if the numbers are here, then people must think that illegal activity happens here. So I, with a group of CAP Asians and the community, we decided to kind of like bridge the gap between the numbers and kind of like re-identify the community. And we did this through a small work of art. It's literally just paint and us kind of like incorporating the numbers into the mural, as well as like adding more shapes and different Chinese characters to it. And that's pretty much what I looked at.
So after the, I think there is another thing I want to mention a little bit is about like, finally we made a big presentation and the university with the local students. It was great. Like the whole room was like so full and people standing on the corridor. Like, and I also think it's probably good to, I interviewed them later about what their local students' view about the planning, what their view about the community, and what their view about CAP Asia. And I made a little video to show you guys what that is.
When I first entered that community, I regarded this place as scruffy and unappealing because there are trash on the ground, disorganized stores everywhere, and so forth. However, as we worked around in that community, I found this place was actually more dynamic, more lively than other so-called well-designed community.
Before the research, I don't think this old community has any difference with the other. Even guessed, this bad quality of construction will be taken down in the future old city reconstruction. During the research, I realized the wisdom of collective. All the members chose the direction of interest. Market, tube, advertisement, pavilion, mahjong, disabled man. Focus on the perspective of all. Maybe we see the truth. It's a very vibrant community.
只是觉得这是一个很普通的社区，传统老旧，并没有什么特别的地方。但是之后随着和居民们的交谈，包括参与到他们的日常当中，我发现这个社区相比较一些别的新的社区而言，这个社区显得更有人气，更有生活的气息。所以说，社区带给居民的这种幸福感。 并没有因为社区的老旧而降低，相反，大部分住在这里的人都觉得生活在这里非常充实，非常的快乐。所以如果说在之前这个社区给我的印象是一个普通的，甚至有些无聊的这种感觉，在这次调研之后，它给我的感觉是一个独特的一个。
有归属感、充满活力的社区。在没参加 CAP Asia 之前，我一直以为一个好的小区规划是通而不畅的道路，是绿树成荫的绿化，是完善的健身娱乐设施。但是，通过半个月的深入小区生活的调研，我才明白，一个好的小区规划其实是创造一系列让人们自由发挥的公共空间。
In-between space research, we found people have their agency and they have ideas or ability to reconstruct their living environment. In this case, whether it is more suitable to give people some freedom to let them plan for themselves.
In front of the house, play mahjong with neighbors, pick vegetables together in the pavilion, chat with a disabled man. I think it's hard to create this sense of belonging and vibrant in a aspect of planning because of this energy come from management and the community relationships. It's very limited things can do for an urban plan designer. For the results of the research, I considered could it be used as decision base for an urban plan administration.
这次调研中，我看到了人与人之间的互动，人与环境之间的互动，还有人在环境中的体验感和氛围，这些同样也是需要规划师去考虑的。
Very beginning, I was wondering that the CAP Asia team may need us to show you around the whole Changsha city and then you would pick up a place to keep on digging things or doing a plan. But I was totally wrong about it. It was surprised that you start from a small community which I think is dirty and my partner Rebecca, who I really miss, and I observe this community from a small margin place. After this, I have a new awareness about how to do the investigation. During our own planning process, we just have a glance at the construction situation, surroundings, land type, and other factors. But we do not take the opinions and ideas of local residents into consideration. What impressed me is that members of CAP Asia team join the community happily, such as dancing with elms in the square to let themselves integrate into this community and know the ideas of the residents.
I think this survey of community is a very interesting and unforgettable experience for me. It is you, all the CAP Asia members, who helped me a lot. It's too nice to know you. Thank you very much.
It was CAP Asia students' strange questions pushed me to probe those ordinary and small things. It was in CAP Asia that I first tried to make friends, with local people, with people living in our site. It was also in CAP Asia that I realized how bad our planning could be if we ignore people. Thank you very much. Thank you for offering us such good and valuable opportunity to join this program. Thank you.
I hope that everyone could join CAP Asia and enjoy the amazing journey.
So I will conclude a little bit. Research, what we got the most, like we learned how to truly understand the aspirations, like understand the people's process. So I've participated CAP Asia twice. Maybe I'm the only one, I'm unique. But for me, when I went to the first CAP Asia, I realized like every place is so different to me. Like every place is full of different people. They're some of rich, some of poor, they're struggled. Every place is different. But after the second CAP Asia, I just realized every place become the same to me. Because since every place is different, it's the same. So no matter where you go, they're just a different place with different people, with all the individual different needs. So conducting the participative observation, so people go to the community, talk to them. And I think what the amazing thing they do is we actually live in a world like everybody is living in a duality. So something is either right or wrong. So something is like, if we make a plan, either it's good or bad. So actually there are a lot of things which is very hard to define whether it's good or bad. Actually, I think the team, they try to get rid of these dualities. They truly understand what is happening there. So we are not defining them. So we are not also going there to help them. And by conducting a plan, as a planner, we should not think that we know everything. We go there with the questions we have in our mind, and we only get the answers with those questions, which when we now all talk about diversity, what diversity came from. I think different people have different needs, which then they create the things they want, then they become diversity. While you are all doing a plan in the same set of questions in your mind and you go into the site, how you expect you create something called diversity? And also, we don't pay attention to the small things. We all think at a big structure, the plans we make. I think I'm really tired of making plans anymore since we don't focus on how to deliver a plan. What are people doing with the plan? How we should evaluate a plan? Like, have you ever thought about that? Like, how I can say this is a good plan or not, from a magazine or from the people who live there? So I think I read some sentence from James Scott's book about the weapons of the weak. he also says that like the vessels, if they like have a wreck in the sea, usually you only see the wreck itself. You don't know actually it's the hidden rocks actually made it work. So actually all these things you find like common and you ignore in planning is actually the things that are making plan fail, because they are not following your process. You design a space, but they use it in a different way. But take it to another way. So if we say, if we do a plan, but we accept the failures, so we don't think we are planner, we are everything. We go there, make plans for people. We think we make plans, but we are not controlling them. So they have the freedom to build. So the governance will not reach the ground. Then people will have the freedom to build. So by accepting the failure of the planning, actually your plan will be successful in a certain way. So I like very thanks for to like Professor Nihal provide us this fabulous opportunity, and thanks our department provide us like assistantship while we are going there. So to make it work. That's it. And I hope you guys, if you have a chance, you really should come and like see us. It's fantastic in Asia and it should be in every place. So thank you.
Thank you so much for listening. And we have a few like little things to go. So I would like to invite Professor Nihal to give us some more information and also some insights about CAP Asia. And also during his talk, I will pass this jar around the room. If you guys have not signed up, you have not put your name in here for the raffle draw, please do that. And he will give us a few words and also lead the Q&A session.
You all saw what the students did and so on, what the Chinese students found out about it, you know, and so on. And then people like Simran have come here to kind of like study. I think I would like to invite you to that area so that, you know, they have a little raffle draw, you know, like where they have a draw, you know, some small presents for the people who attended. So if you could please come there, it's fine. But I just want you to play that thing one more time, and then you go. The last.
Sorry, you cannot push it. You can only play from the beginning to the end.
Okay, I thought it was a good ending, but anyway, okay. So it doesn't matter. So thanks very much for coming. Okay.
And if you're wondering about those numbers on the wall, so as Nelly talked about, we are going to make a mural out of that. You all can participate, and Rebecca's mom is making a tetari, right?
Means yeah. Malaysian tea.
Malaysian tea. Yeah. So you all can enjoy some tea in the atrium while you can participate in the mural also. So since Christine wants to go.
Yeah, so everyone's okay, Christine. So Christine is someone who was like saving us from here. She was here, we were in Asia, and she was taking care of so many things.
My roommate.